There's a certain sparseness or an angularity that I would recognize very quickly. With Harry, it's sometimes quirky and rhythmically exciting, rhythmically demanding. It can be quite astringent at times, which I like, although he does have a very, very lyrical side, which I think he's almost afraid to show sometimes. You know, it's not very modern to show that, but but it's there, and it's wonderful when it comes out.
I also hear very distinct cutoffs, like sort of sharpness to a descending line, and that's it. Lots of complicated rhythms.
I think the thing that I've always been impressed by about him was his chameleon qualities, that he was equal to almost any compositional circumstance. He was and is a composer in the old sense. Before they worried about the composer as artist, they were composers as craftsmen. And he is that. You give him a ballet to do, he'll do it. You give him a film to do, he'll do it. You have different styles, he can adapt to them. And I think that's because he has a very secure technique. And he also has a secure sense of himself, so he's not worried about making stylistic changes for the sake of the particular project. It will still come out Freedman. The fact that he had a quirky rhythmic sense, a lot of his music has a rhythmic profile that isn't all that predictable, and I think partly that is his jazz background, but it goes long beyond that, because as a jazz player and jazz admirer, he liked improvisation. So I think some of his music has a kind of flexibility in it because the players themselves who are performing have been given more discretion than many players in many pieces. So that gives them a certain looseness. This, I guess, makes him in some ways a bit elusive. You can't say there is a big stamp of Freedman. Freedman seeps through, but I think you have to hear a lot of Freedman before you know it's Freedman.
Fortunately, there's a lot of Freedman to hear. There's not a lot of it on compact disc, mind you, but enough to get the measure of the man. You could start with Oiseau Exotique and Rose la Tulipe. You could dig the playing of Jerry Mulligan on the concerto Freedman wrote for him, and listen to collections of his vocal and orchestral music. But these few CDs represent only a tiny fraction of his output. What's more, he isn't being played anywhere nearly as much today as he was in the 60s and 70s. But Freedman hasn't allowed this relative neglect to discourage him. He did go through a bad patch for a while, but the well never ran dry. His resilience may well have its roots in his jazz background, or it may be something more fundamental.